So it's a great pleasure for us to welcome Professor Dr. Alexander Heisenkamp here. So I'm Mitsuro Terakawa of Keio University, and I'll be introducing him. So before his talk, let me just briefly introduce Professor Heisenkamp. He's an expert in biomedical optics with special interest in nonlinear imaging and manipulation of cells and tissues, and laser therapy and diagnostics, and also nanoparticle laser interaction. He holds a professorship for biophotonics at Leibniz University, Hannover, and is a scientific director at Laser Centrum Hannover. And also, this year, he's a distinguished guest professor of this Keio University, Japan. He's a fellow of SPIE and also involved in many projects and many communities and societies. And then he recently member of the two very large cluster in Germany, and the one is the excellent cluster of Rebus, and he's a leader of the research group of cell surgery. And also he also a member of the excellent cluster Hearing for All. So actually we have two lectures from him. One from part one is today, and part two is tomorrow. So today's topic is mostly on the microscope. And then, yeah, let's give a big hand to welcome him.
Yeah, thank you very much for the kind introduction, and even more for to the whole Terakawa group, and to especially Professor Terakawa for hosting me here and for our collaboration. And I hope we continue and strengthen our collaboration with this visit and further visits. So, as Mitsuhiro already outlined, I prepared two lectures. So one basically about microscopy and you could say laser-based imaging in the field of biomedical optics, but several of these concepts apply as well to other materials as well. And for tomorrow, I prepared a lecture on, you could say, laser treatment or using lasers other than doing imaging, so manipulation or ablation or these things in the field of medicine and biology. And these lectures I prepared such that it's on one hand, it's really a lecture, so I bring you some of the fundamentals of these techniques and give you an overview of the field. And then at some points I mix it together with our developments, what we do in our group, so that you have on both hands, you see, okay, on one hand you get the basics of microscopy, and on the other hand, maybe get some insights what we do in Hannover with this. Of course, I mean, usually I teach microscopy, for example, as a bachelor or master's course, and that takes a full semester, so I had to squeeze in a lot. It's not that I'm going to talk 12 times faster, yeah, but I cannot outline all the fundamentals, but I give you some idea what are the concepts and like Abbe's limit or contrast modalities. But of course, it's not that I can basically cover the whole field with these lectures. But as it's a lecture, in my lectures, you're free to ask questions during the lecture. So if you stumble upon something, you can just interrupt me and ask your questions. Because as it's a very broad field, it will be probably hard for you to remember at the end of the talk and come back. So you're free to ask questions like you'd like. So to me, I'm professor at Leibniz University in Hannover. So that's sort of right in the middle of Germany. So it's by train, it's 1.5 hours to Berlin and maybe 1 hour to Hamburg, and something like, okay, on the bottom, it's 4 hours to Munich. And I'm affiliated with several institutions. So I'm a professor at the university. That's where I teach basically and take the exams. And then for a long time, I have been affiliated with the Laser Center in Hannover, which is an institute apart from the university trying to apply the fundamental research to industrial applications. And now since recently, and partly because of this cluster as well, which is this Rebus, this excellence cluster where we work jointly together with medical people and engineers on the topics of regenerative medicine, We got funding for a new building where basically all the people working within these clusters come together and work at one place. So it's an interdisciplinary research building from the Medical University in Hanover, the Veterinary School of Hanover, and the Leibniz University in Hanover. So sort of the medical disciplines together with chemists, engineers, and physicists working on. So first, I come back to, so you can contact me by email if you have any further ideas or questions, but I have that on the last slide as well. So here are some people of my group working at this KNIFE building, this interdisciplinary research center. And in my group, we cover basically, like I said, both sides of laser applications. On one hand, saying, okay, we use lasers for diagnostics and imaging. And on the other hand, we use it for therapy or manipulation. And that mostly resembles the work I do in my group. And that's resembled by the two lectures I am giving you today. So you could say the part B is basically the lecture today, and the part A is a lecture tomorrow. But first, I want to motivate you, because I spoke, okay, imaging and regenerative medicine. What is regenerative medicine? So I often use this picture from Cranach the Elder, a medieval painting. And he depicted the fountain of youth. Probably all of you have heard of it already. So it's a fountain, supposedly, where you can hop in from one side, or not really hop in. You see the elderly and weak people are coming in from the left side, taking a bath in this fountain of youth, and they get out very young and healed again. Yeah, so that has been a long time vision of mankind, to sort of overcome diseases and even aging. And part of it, you can say, is because our body doesn't really regenerate fully in all parts. So you could say if you have a severe knee injury, the cartilage in your knee can heal, but it doesn't really recover to its full function. So you all know, if you have a severe knee injury as a football player, for example, yeah, probably your career might end. Yeah, and very similar, it's with if you get a heart attack. Yeah, so if your heart muscle is permanently damaged, it doesn't rebuild or regenerate. So heart muscle tissue is very sensitive tissue, similar as neural tissue in the brain, and it doesn't regenerate. So the cells in the heart muscle are, as we call it, finally differentiated. They don't divide anymore. So if you have one damage, there's no wound healing in that sense in this tissue. But we know from nature that some animals or parts really exhibit great capacities of regeneration. So this is one of the most famous animals of regeneration, is this axolotl lizard. Yeah, usually lives in America, close, for example, Mexico. And maybe you know from lizards that they can throw off their tail and it regrows within 2 weeks. Yeah, but with this axolotl lizards, you can even chop up, for example, one limb. And you see within 21 days, the extremity fully regrows. Yeah? So, and it's not only limited in this animal to the extremities. You can even cut out half the brain. You can cut out the complete liver and organs, and they regrow. Yeah? And there you see, okay, that's maybe a dream of regenerative medicine, that you somehow can transfer the capacity of regeneration from these biological systems to human systems to make, for example, heart muscle tissue regrow and regenerate as we know it from lizards. Yeah. One clinical example from which already is pursued in rebirth, in this cluster I've showed you from the cardiovascular surgeons, is that they are using the regenerative capacity and helping the human body to use this in the case of heart valves. Yeah? So you know that one can build artificial heart valves, but they have several back draws. And one, for example, of these heart valves is that they don't grow with age. So if you have a children, yeah, and you have to implant an artificial heart valve, they basically have to undergo surgery up to 4 times, because the heart grows and you have to match the size of the vessels. Yeah? And the technique developed in Hanover is such that you take a heart valve from a donor patient, from a donor heart, and you wash off all the cells, and afterwards you implant this basically cartilage structure from a human body which doesn't have any own cells anymore, so it doesn't trigger an immune response, and then afterwards it is reseeded with patient cells within the heart of the patient. Yeah, so you see this has been on German television out up to now in Hanover. Over 450 patients have been treated, and you see here a young boy who suffers from a malfunction at this valve, and you see one valve is extracted, and afterwards in a certain solution the cells are washed off. Then this sort of scaffold is implanted into the heart of this boy, and then afterwards the body basically reseeds it with cells, and this is a boy playing soccer after I don't know how many months after surgery. So basically probably up to now none of these 450 patients had to undergo surgery again. And that is one aspect which we follow, and you can imagine, okay, this is a very biological approach where you take a biological specimen, you wash off the cells, and you implant it. But you can think of creating biomaterials to offer such a structure that it's resealed, seeded with cells or other things. You have to basically characterize these implants before and have something like a quality control by, for example, optical imaging techniques and so on. So that's one aspect. And one motivation of the application why I'm working with microscopy in the biomedical optics field. And in the lecture, I first will give you some basics of microscopy and laser-based approaches and put in some of our applications there as well. Okay, so if we look at several imaging techniques in medicine, I plotted the different techniques here with the abbreviations over the resolution which you can achieve. So what's the minimal structure you can recognize with this imaging technique over the sample size? Yeah? So if you think now, for example, when we saw the beating heart of this young boy, it basically, okay, the boy has sizes several centimeters in scale up to a meter. So you see then most of the optical imaging techniques don't apply because the sample size is such that it's so large you cannot put that under your microscope. Yeah? So if you want to have microscopic resolution, most of these techniques apply, and you see you can have maybe sample sizes up to a millimeter. Yeah? And that's one major drawback of optical techniques, that because of the optical penetration depth, the applicability of these techniques is very limited to surfaces and very small specimens. So in the upper part here, which you can use clinically on whole humans, is, for example, ultrasound, MRI imaging, CT, X-ray imaging, magnetic resonance imaging, or positron electron tomography. Okay, and I cover basically these other techniques. So you see all these techniques, fluorescent molecular tomography, optical projection tomography, and optical coherence tomography, they all end with a T. So it's a tomographic technique. So you can sort of have a 3D imaging and reconstruct the 3D structure of these things. And then at higher resolution, you have multiphoton microscopy, confocal microscopy, and basically light microscopy in this range. And then you see below basically half of the wavelengths of the light you're using, maybe 500 nanometer, smaller, 250 nanometer. Most of the conventionally used techniques is SEM and TEM, so electron microscopy. And I gave you some insight, okay, how can you use optical techniques to image these structures, as well as, of course, electron microscopy is restricted to dead specimens, so you cannot have a live cell imaging with this technique. So most of the lecture will basically cover this area which I showed you here in red. But first of all, I want to motivate, why are we limited to this regime once we apply optics? And this is basically, if you look at the different wavelengths of light and look at the absorption coefficient, and the inverse of the absorption coefficient is the penetration depth. So if you have a very low absorption coefficient of 10 to the power of minus 6, yeah, you get a very high penetration depth. Yeah. And if we look, for example, our body consists between 75 to 90% out of water, usually you would say, okay, the absorption coefficient is very low in the visible range. Yeah. So usually we should have penetration depths of several meters in tissue if we think of it as water. Yeah, you all know from water, you can easily see several meters in water in the visible. So why is that? It's because, for example, we have certain substances. I plot in here one famous one, blood. You see the absorption coefficient of blood, and this already reduces the penetration depths dramatically. You can put in other proteins like melanin, the skin protein, and other things, and that's basically already reducing the penetration depths. On top of that, you have scattering. I come back to scattering, how that basically originates a little bit later in the lecture, but let's just say, okay, you have two mechanisms in tissue. One is, okay, the photon can be absorbed. The other one, it can be deflected from its original part. And one key message of the lecture already is that scattering is always worse in tissue than absorption. So your main problem in optical imaging in tissue is scattering. Yeah. But you see, okay, it's quite high, the scattering, but you see the basically it's reduced with longer wavelengths. Yeah? So that's another part. So if you want to reduce scattering in tissue, you can apply longer wavelengths. Yeah? But you see, then of course, you have to level somehow, you have this absorption curve of water, and this is going up in the infrared. Yeah? So at some point, you see the scattering is crossing the absorption of water, and then absorption of water dominates. So longer wavelengths are good, but not too long wavelengths until your water absorbs. And that's where you are in the so-called diagnostic window, where you can use near-infrared wavelengths to get the highest penetration depths in tissue. And that's maybe you see it on the side. Several hundreds of microns you can achieve of penetration depths in tissue. Okay, and this is, if you now plot some imaging modalities, so with a naked eye, just from the resolution you can achieve, that's not now penetration depths, that's more like, okay, we know with the naked eye, we can maybe see a single hair with the naked eye. So that's a resolution of something like 100 micron. And a light microscope usually works in this range from several hundreds of micron down to half the wavelength, so something like maybe 200, 250 nanometer. And then, so you see, okay, a single cell you can nicely resolve with optical imaging, but a single bacterium is already hard with normal light microscope. With an electron microscope, okay, you can go much further. Yeah. So if we think now of a simple or the most simple microscope, it's very, very simple. Yeah, you can think of it as just one lens. Yeah, and this is one of the first, one could say, microscopes, a magnifying lens found in Iraq. Yeah, and you see it's a so-called Nimrud lens. It's a polished piece of glass. Yeah. And it has some magnifying effect, but you see, okay, of course, the impurities are not so nice, but it's basically might have been used to overcome presbyopia, so a form of farsightedness in at older age. Yeah. Not so different, but quite some time later, Antony van Leeuwenhoek developed the first, you could say, really high-resolution microscope in the late 17th century. And it looked different from the first look at it. Yeah? So you see this is basically a brass plate with a little pinhole in it. Yeah? And then you have a little needle which you can adjust in one direction. And usually on top of the needle you would have your specimen. So what you see, this aperture here is sort of your imaging place. Yeah? And on top of this aperture, he glued a glass bead. Yeah? So you have a tiny little glass bead glued to this aperture. And if you think of a glass bead, a sphere, it's basically a very strong refractive lens because the curvature is very strong if you have a tiny ball of glass. Yeah? So you have a very high refractive power. And if you have a very high refractive power, you have to be very close at the focal length of this lens to get a sharp imaging. Therefore, the specimen is very close to this little glass sphere, and you have to put your eyes as well very close. So you took this brass plate and you basically put it in your eye, held the other one shut, and then tried to see through the aperture on your magnifying object. Yeah? So you can look at, I mean, if you come to a microscope museum in Jena, they have, for example, some of these, or in the German Technical Museum in Munich, several of them are shown and displayed there. And this is one sketch he drew, and you have to remember, he drew that in the 17th century, these pictures. And you can see, okay, these are basically sperm cells, and then on the upper one, he put some organisms he found in a water ditch outside of his house. So he could already see, like, single, if you want, cells from humans, sperm cells. And that was as a time when basically the humans believed in the homunculus, so that basically the men gave life to the woman as a complete form, a complete little human was given to the woman, and then it grew inside the womb of the woman and she gave birth to it. That was because, in the Middle Ages, people couldn't imagine that the wife or the woman had to do anything with the offspring of life, so it was basically coming from the male people, And at that time, he discovered already how that it's actually not a single human you give to the woman, but you have the sperm cells, and you see, he could even see, malformations of these sperm cells already, he saw, in the late 17th century. Okay, it's another aspect I teach my students in that lecture. I could go on, why wasn't that really recognized that widely? One problem is he published in Dutch and not in the normal, let's say in Latin or English, like with the Royal Society in England, And he didn't tell anyone how he made this perfect or nearly perfect glass lens, So his knowledge was lost after he died, because he didn't work scientifically to write it up and basically share it with the colleagues. And therefore, it took some time to reinvent these. At that time, people tried to polish or reach perfect lenses by polishing with finer and finer sand grains. And today, we assume that he probably made it by cooling glass or heating glass and cooling it very rapidly so that you basically have little sparks of glass flying off. And because of the surface tension of the glass, by cooling, you get a round shape with nearly perfect optical interfaces at that. But you see at about the same time with the bad lenses, imperfect lenses, Zacharias Janssen developed a different kind of microscope which was more comfortable to use. And it was a first compound microscope. So it doesn't have only this high refractive lens at one end, which we call objective, because it's placed at the object or close to the object. He took a second lens, which is closer to the eye, oculus, the ocular, and thereby he could image the magnified image into the eye of the observer. And that has basically two advantages. Okay, first you have to don't have to put it near to the eye, and you can look at it in infinity, so you have a relaxed eye, it doesn't really, it's no effort to look through the microscope, and it's an upright image already. So, and if you will, the most standard microscopes you probably have in your labs are very similar. They are a two-lens compound microscope with a fixed distance between these two lenses. One lens, the objective lens, you see here, is the objective is the high refractive lens, and then you have the ocular on top with a low, and the total magnification is basically magnification of both lenses as a product of these. So why is the resolution of these microscopes limited? It's basically because of diffraction. So you probably know from your fundamental optics lectures that light is causing interference and is refractive and basically propagates as a wave. And therefore, if you do it right and you take an image of this razor blade, you can image the diffraction rings caused by this hard aperture or basically this hard edge of this one. If you transfer that to not a razor blade, but you imagine you have this little aperture like van Leeuwenhoek used it, or you have basically the limiting aperture of your imaging lens, you get such an image. Yeah, so you get the diffraction pattern, which we call airy disk. Yeah? And if you have now two structures, and they are very close together, you cannot tell is that now really one or two light sources or two tiny spots. Yeah, you see it plotted here. Yeah, this is basically the light distribution of one spot or scattering object, let's say, for example. And if they are very close together, you can resolve them if one of them is at the minimum of the second one, so at the first minimum of these airy disks. Yeah. This is what we call the Rayleigh criteria of resolution. Then we say we can resolve two objects, because this is what you see here. You get this structure, and there you say, okay, I see two objects here. At this point, you cannot be sure, is this one object or are these two objects? Yeah? Of course, if they are further apart, it's much easier. Yeah? And if you calculate that more strictly, you can come up with a formula, what structures you can resolve and what structures not. And the first who actually put that into mathematic formulas was Ernst Abbe, at that time in Jena. And he was working together with Carl Zeiss. Yeah? So Carl Zeiss was a very skilled mechanic or optics engineer, if you will. But at his time of Carl Zeiss, the knowledge of optics was more transferred from father to son, and it was more a craftsmanship. And so in being good in polishing lenses and knowing where you have to put the lenses, but no one calculated where do you have to put the lens. If you build your optics setup and you do some imaging, you would probably first calculate, okay, what lenses do I need? What distances can I use? And then you set it and you basically align it a little bit, but you can calculate it. At that time, from Carl Zeiss, no one calculated that. And Ernst Abbe was the first to put that into formula. Afterwards, he took over the company from Carl Zeiss, and actually he was a very good salesman and CEO as well. He wrote really whole essays about union and insurance of employees and so on. Yeah, so he was basically, that was maybe as well one reason why the company Carl Zeiss got really that big at this time. But of course, one thing was he was able to calculate his instruments and build the best microscopes at that time. Another reason might be because Otto Schott had his glass production in Jena as well, so he had basically the guy being able to perform make the best glass lenses together with the one who calculates it, so it was a really good union there they had. Okay, and if you do the math, probably you have seen this formula, and it's so important in optics that this is a monument in Jena, it's carved into stone. Yeah. You see the minimum resolution you can resolve with a microscope is roughly half the wavelength. So you see the wavelength of light divided by 2 times the refractive index the sinus of the opening angle of your microscope, or half the opening angle of your microscope. So the n times sinus alpha is the numerical aperture of your microscope. And usually your objective lenses, this numerical aperture can be between 0 and 1, because you have a sinus there and you see, okay, the opening angle of a lens, if you see, can be maximum, if it's half the opening angle, can be maximum 90 degree, and the sinus of 90 degree is 1. So this number cannot exceed 1. Yeah, okay, but you have the refractive index there. If you imagine you have, for example, a refractive index like oil or other things, immersion oil with 1.6, for example, you can achieve a numerical aperture with immersion fluid of, for example, 1.6. That's why the highest magnification lenses you usually have are maybe about 1.4 Na. Yeah, okay, if you have silicon optics and so on, you can have higher Na, but in optical imaging, that's the highest Na you can get. So you see, the resolution then, in other terms, if you use visible wavelengths of 500 nanometer, your resolution you can resolve is maybe 200 nanometer. Then these spots overlap and you cannot resolve a finer structure. Yeah? And this is what you see here. If you have a microscope, you see you have, of course, the magnification 50x, but plotted behind that you have the numerical aperture, this n times the sinus alpha, which is in this case, for example, 0.9. So you could calculate the minimum resolution you can get with this microscope if you use, and that's written here, oil with a certain refractive index then. Okay. Another point, and that's, again, that's maybe a whole 1.5 hours I can talk, is basically this up here, this coloring. I don't know if you realize, but these objectives doesn't need to be Zeiss, can be Nikon, or they are very similar built up as well. But the color coding is sometimes a little bit different depending on the manufacturer. You see that the writing here is, for example, in black. And then maybe you realize sometimes you have objectives which are have a red writing on it, or they have a green writing on it. And that's referring to the contrast modality of it. Usually if you just want to do light microscopy or want to use a laser, you should use probably a black writing on it, because it works with standard contrast. If it's a red one, it's, for example, a polarization-sensitive microscope. So it has a certain optics in it which rotates the polarization, and basically upon traveling back, you have a second polarizer, and thereby you can measure to what degree your sample rotates the polarization. Or you have a phase microscope, which is just measuring the optical path your light experiences or takes when it travels through the specimen. So briefly, you can look at phase objects or amplitude objects in microscopy. So an amplitude object would be just you sending light through it, and your amplitude of the light is attenuated. For example, some parts of your specimen look black, otherwise are bright, so you have a black and white contrast. So you're measuring amplitude. In phase, it's just different. Ideally, you're sample might be completely transparent for it, and you're just measuring the phase delay this wave experiences, meaning, okay, you have maybe, let's say, a higher refractive index here, then the wave takes longer time to travel through, and if you have a reference wave not traveling through your specimen, you can overlap the two and measure the interference and thereby measure the optical path lengths. And to do that, you need a certain kind of objective which can basically has something like a reference arm, if you will, and which can overlay them to and thereby measure the phase contrast. I'm not covering phase contrast today because it would take too long, but just as a matter. So I will concentrate on amplitude objects, but not so much that I say, okay, I'm looking at the attenuation of light, but rather, if you think of the amplitude goes down, the energy has to go somewhere. And one major application in microscopy is that this absorbed light is transferred into fluorescence light, and you can detect this fluorescence light. I come to that as well. Or if you use other modalities like nonlinear microscopy, this light can be converted directly into other light. So without doing this transition of fluorescence and then coming back, I come back to that. But just give you an idea of how a phase microscope image looks like. This is a phase microscope image of a cell over time, and you can basically see that it's, okay, this is how the cell grows or basically migrates. And you see you have certain structures inside. Clearly you can see the nucleus because the nucleus is much more densely packed with the DNA. And in the cytosol, you have other structures, but in the nucleus, you have the highest refractive index, and that's why you can see it such clearly. But the other structures of the cell, you cannot really tell apart. You cannot see where was the cytoskeleton, where are the microtubuli, where are the mitochondria, and so on. We cannot distinguish this with phase microscopes. And one major mechanism we need is the Stokes shift, which means if you're sending in light and this is absorbed, so this is basically the absorbed light, then materials can send out light when they fluoresce, and usually this light which is emitted by these samples is redshifted, which means it has a longer wavelength compared to the incoming light. This is because, okay, if you think of energies, you have a maximum of energy you're sending in, and then inside your system you have maybe some conversion into heat of this light, and some of this light is basically sent back as fluorescence light, so this loss of heat is resembled in a longer wavelengths because you have less energy, and the energy of a photon scales with the frequency, so therefore you have a longer wavelength with less energy. But it's another, it's basically a really a nice thing to have this energy loss if you look at the second side, because you see the light you're sending in is at one wavelength and the light you want to see is at another wavelength. So if you put in a filter which blocks basically this blue light, you can detect only the red light. And this is a standard dichroic mirror we use in a microscope. And you see the advantage right away in this image. Yeah? For example, this is a bright field image. So you're sending in white light into your specimen, and you see barely the outline of the cells. Yeah? So this is just the attenuation of the amplitude I told you before. Yeah? And as cells mostly consist of water, they absorb a little bit, but not too much. Yeah? But if I put in a filter and I'm just detecting the fluorescence light of these cells, and I stained these cells with a certain kind of dye, MitoTracker orange, yeah? You see it's now orange color. And the main advantage of fluorescence microscopy is that you get a maximum of contrast. Yeah? So the resolution is still comparable, and we are not really at the resolution limit of the microscope, but you see the contrast is maximum, because where I have a cell, it's orange. Where I have no cell, it's black. Yeah? And that's one main concept of fluorescence microscopy. You're using a dichroic mirror to basically get rid of the background and have a maximum of contrast. Yeah? And then this is an example. Okay, you have a dye which accumulates in the mitochondria, something like the power station of, or powerhouses of a cell. But another important thing is, for example, you want to label certain structures. And you can, for example, use antibodies. And this is one excerpt from a famous paper from Kunz and Kaplan, who developed the immunohistology, meaning, okay, they were able to target certain structures in a body to make them fluorescent. Yeah, and have maximum of contrast. So that was really a breakthrough at that time, because then you could see certain structures in tissue with fluorescence, with maximum contrast. But another breakthrough much more recently has been developed with, or has been gained with the so-called fluorescent proteins, and especially it started with a green fluorescent protein. and you see that this green fluorescent protein was isolated from a jellyfish, Aquaria victoria. And that was already done in the 60s by Shimomura. Yeah? And at his time, I read a story how they basically, he had his whole family to collect samples from the ocean. I think he lived in Nagasaki, if I remember it right, and collected jellyfish samples. And to be able to get some detectable amount of fluorescent protein, he had to collect 2.5 tons of jellyfish. Yeah? And then he was able to isolate this green fluorescent protein and show that this is basically responsible for the bright fluorescence some of these jellyfish exhibit. Yeah? And then later, Roger Sien and Chalfi used it to basically insert the genetic code for these green fluorescent proteins into other living organisms, like, for example, this C. elegans worm, and they could couple it with the DNA, usually, for example, responsible for the neural system in this worm, and then automatically, every time a neuron is built in these organisms, it shines up with a green fluorescent protein, so you could now basically target living structures and living cells with fluorescence microscopy. And that's why the Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded in 2008 for these three people, because it's really a major breakthrough in live cell biology or live cell microscopy nowadays, because you can use these fluorescent proteins to label living systems and study them at a micrometer scale while they are living. Yeah, and not stain them afterwards like a snapshot. So you see here different structures like the mitochondria here, or whole cells, the actin filament, and so on. This is a typical chemical structure of the green fluorescent protein, but what you see here is that it's not only the green fluorescent protein what is out there nowadays. Yeah, people were able to isolate really a whole color scheme of fusion proteins, which you can insert, and you can do something like multicolor imaging with fluorescence microscopy in living cells. Yeah? And how do you build a microscope? Like I said, it's still very simple. Yeah? You need an excitation light. You have one lens, the objective lens, which basically focuses the light on your sample, and then you're collecting it. You have here the dichroic mirror separating the excitation light from the fluorescence light. You put that on a camera. So here's the second lens, the ocular lens, and then you can basically get an image. Okay, but as I already said, in that image, I stained the cells for mitochondria. Mitochondria is a very fine structure in these cells, something like maybe of 100 nanometer in size or in diameter, and is a network all across the cells. But here, the whole cell shines orange, so we cannot really see the single mitochondria, although I'm used an objective lens with a numerical aperture of 1, and my theoretical resolution limit should be 200 nanometers, so I should be able to barely see the mitochondria. Yeah? So the question is, why do I not get my theoretical resolution right away? And this is because if you look at it, I'm in this scheme, and I'm focusing my light into my sample, and this is my focal plane. So here I have my theoretical minimum resolution, or maximum resolution, minimum limits. Yeah? And I'm exciting the fluorescence in the whole sample. So I'm getting, if you will, stray light or basically disturbing light in the higher and lower focal regions, which reduces or blurs out my image. Yeah? So I'm reducing my contrast and resolution, and you see that more nicely in this graph here, I think by Brett Amos. I have the citation later in What Web, later in my slides as well. So you see here, the fluorescence is excited with a laser beam at 488 nanometer, and here's the focal plane, but you see that a major part of fluorescence is generated before the focal plane, and this all gets onto your camera and blurs out your image. Yeah. So what can you do to improve the resolution to the theoretical resolution of your microscope? One idea would be to block out the rest of the light. So you can think of it, yeah, you're building an optical path, and you think, okay, what optical path is taking the light from the focal plane, and what is the rest doing? And if you do so, this is basically the guy who did it first, Marvin Minsky in 1957. You see the imaging of your light source with a lens into your focal plane, and then he thought, okay, if I have now my focal plane and I image this focal plane on my detector, and I put at certain positions of my light path, I put a pinhole here, and I put a pinhole in the detection path as well, and I image them on one another at the focal plane, I get a so-called confocal imaging setup, because both foci of illumination and detection overlap, then I can block the residual light from out of focal planes. Yeah? And you can do that, he realized already in his patent in 1957, that he can do it just with one lens, so you don't need to split it in one detection and one illumination part. And this is how we do it usually in microscopes, the so-called epi illumination. So from the same side you illuminate and you're detecting, you have a beam splitter here, you put a pinhole here and here, and then you basically get a background-free image of your focus plane. Yeah. So you see, 57, that's already pretty early, and but if you look at when the first commercial confocal microscopes were built, that was maybe in the beginning of 80s. Yeah? So like Nikon and Leica and so on started to sell them heavily in the 80s. You can think of why did it take 30 years? So one thing is, he thought of a light bulb as a light source. That's probably not a perfect light source to image with diffraction limit. If you think of if you use lasers for processing and you want to have a very fine processing, you're using a laser. Yeah? The laser was invented in 61. Yeah? Shortly afterwards, it was used for imaging. Yeah? But on the other hand, you still have to think, okay, if you're using a laser to get here a diffraction-limited point and you're detecting it, you only get a one pixel at a time. So you don't get a full image, but you get a one pixel information of your specimen. Yeah? So what you have to do, you have to collect pixel by pixel the information and put it together on a screen Yeah, what you need is a personal computer, basically. Yeah, you need pixel information to build it together to one image. Yeah, and that's took another 30 years or 20 years to be able. And Brackenhoff was basically the first who then realized the confocal microscope in something like 78. Yeah. And that's how it looks like now. Okay, you have the light source and you have a pinhole here, excitation and then detection, and just really exactly as in Marvin Minsky's patent. Yeah, but sadly a patent lasts only 20 years, so yeah, really just bad luck. Yeah, so. And with this one you get really, first of all, resolution limited microscopy with fluorescence high contrast. And because you're limiting your light to your focal plane, you can do something like a so-called optical sectioning. So you can go through your sample and look at it layer by layer and reconstruct it in 3D. So this is a pollen grain. Yeah, just basically you can think of it as a micron, several micron sized sphere, yeah, with a bright orange shell and a green inside. And you can look at this specimen layer by layer and have a 3D reconstruction on your computer. Okay, a similar technique realized or invented in the 90s by Winfried Denk and colleagues like Peter Sow, for example, is nonlinear microscopy. So it's very similar, but it has the advantage that now they are using infrared light. So remember, that was the light which has the highest penetration depth in tissue. Yeah? But usually, yeah, it's not absorbed. Yeah? Scattering is reduced. So you see, if you look at it in an energy diagram, the energy of one photon is not high enough to excite a fluorescence transition. Yeah? So you see the upper energy level is not reached because the energy of the photon, which is plotted in length, is not high enough. Yeah? But if you think of it, you take two photons built on one another, yeah, you can cross this gap and then have the standard fluorescence transition here. So you see two photons, two near infrared, add up their energy and then drive this fluorescence process. They only do that, yeah, when you have a lot of photons at the same time, at the same place. So which means, okay, if you have one fluorescence molecule, there have to be two photons present to excite the electron into the upper level, which means you need a very high photon density, yeah, and therefore you have to focus the light, and you see then only at the focal plane at the correct power you have this highest probability of this two photon excitation, and you get something like a confocal effect right away. Yeah, you don't need any pinholes anymore. A two photon microscope is always a confocal microscope, if you will. Yeah, and you see that here, in this here, I have the citation here from Watt Webb. You see, this is an excitation of the fluorescence with linear optics, yeah, at 488 nanometer. If I double the wavelengths, yeah, I reduce the energy by a factor of two. Then two photons act on one another, and I get only the fluorescence spot here at the focal plane. Yeah. If you think about it on the probabilities, yeah, one of the first who did that was Marianne Göppert-Meyer in the 20s. She was a theoretical physicist, and she calculated what's the probability to get such a two-photon effect. And these are all standard dyes, yeah, of fluorescence microscopy, for example, Lucifer yellow or DARPI in purple here. It's not so important, but you see that that are all fluorescent standard dyes. Yeah? Probably GFP or something would be very similar. Yeah? And you see the probabilities all in the range of a cross-section of one Göppert-Meyer, because we named it afterwards to honor her. And you see one Göppert-Meyer is 1 time 10 to the power of minus 50 a centimeter to the power of 4 times second squared. So I mean, the units are not really important. What I want to motivate is it's a very small number. Yeah? So the probability of a two-photon transition is negligible small. Yeah? So in our real world outside, we don't have two-photon absorption. Yeah? You see, if you calculate it, you take the power of the sun and basically at noon, yeah, how much power we have basically hitting 1 square meter, and you say, okay, I'm putting one dye molecule in this light intensity of the sun, yeah, I get a one photon absorption every second of a standard dye. Yeah? And this dye molecule would make two photon absorption every 10 million years because the probability is so low. Yeah? You can of course say, okay, 10 million years, yeah, to have it maybe within an hour, I could say I take it times 200 million, yeah? But then I would burn my sample right away. If you think you increase the intensity of the sun by a factor of 200 million, yeah, you would burn any sample right away. So the trick is what we do now, and that's another whole lecture, but I think most of you know about femtosecond lasers, that they squeeze in a tiny bit of energy in a very short time. So you have to imagine you have the sun, you switch it off, and you switch it on for a very brief time with the same energy, and thereby the intensity is tremendously high. Yeah? Although the whole energy is really the same, so which means you can, at moderate powers of a milliwatt, you can achieve peak powers of a terawatt per square centimeter. Yeah? And these high peak powers, on one hand, we will see tomorrow as well, but you know probably as well, you can ablate material very precisely without getting too much heat into the sample, but you can use it for imaging as well. So at lower powers, you can use this two-photon transition to excite fluorescence. Yeah? And this is how a simple microscope then would look like. You take your standard microscope, you take a beam splitter, put it in the light path, and take a scanning mirrors and scan your femtosecond beam over your sample, and you can have a two-photon transition. You get a confocal-like effect and get a very high-resolution microscope. Yeah? Of course, okay, the camera, you need a special camera. You cannot do that with a 200 euro camera. It has to be an EMCCD. But you can do it with a camera, or you can use a photomultiplier. Yeah? And that's really, I mean, you can go on the web, you find a build your own two-photon microscope with a free version of download of software, and you can build your own nonlinear microscope. Yeah? But okay, it's some effort. I did it from the web once. It takes maybe half a year to get all the software going and so on. But it's not that really. Or you can buy it from Zeiss or Leica, and then it's maybe 250,000 euro or so. I think our most expensive part is, of course, the femtosecond laser. Yeah? So if you have that already, you can order a ThorLab setup with software for, I think, maybe 90,000 euro or so. Okay, and if you now scan these cells, which I've shown you before, then we can really get diffraction-limited imaging. Yeah? So there we use now really the full possibility of our objective lens. You see the single mitochondria building a network in the nucleus of the cell. You have no mitochondria, so you see some mitochondria on top and below. Yeah? And you can use near-infrared wavelengths to get really high penetration depth. So a lot of what we do is, for example, apply this nonlinear imaging modalities to reach high penetration depths. Yeah? So I told you already about like this two-photon absorption to get fluorescence. On the other hand, this nonlinear process, I mean, if you had a course on nonlinear optics, you know, okay, this two-photon absorption is just one process based on the nonlinear susceptibilities of media. But there are other orders of nonlinearities where, for example, you can have a conversion of two photons directly into one short wavelength photon, which we call second harmonic generation. You probably all know that, yeah, from the laser pointers where you have, okay, this one is in red, but there are green laser pointers. They usually have a nonlinear crystal in it, which converts two infrared photons into a green photon. Yeah? And you can do the same, but you don't use a crystal. You use structures in the biological material which are similar like structures. So again, I cannot go into detail, but you can actually do nonlinear optics like you are used from crystal optics in the human body. And one crystal, for example, and the most prominent one, which resembles these asymmetric crystals, is collagen molecule, which is a very long molecule aligned like a uniaxial crystal. And at this molecule, you basically get this process very dominantly, and you can detect collagen with this nonlinear optics, for example, in tissue. Yeah, what are you doing? You're using infrared wavelengths, and you're detecting light coming back at half the wavelengths. Yeah, you have a very high sensitive detector, and instantly this light is converted into short wavelength light. Yeah? And then even more sophisticated, the ones who had nonlinear optics know that you can have even wave mixing in nonlinear optics, meaning, okay, of course you can have maybe two times the same wavelengths of the incoming photon and a second other wavelengths, mix them together in the material to get a fourth wavelength, which we call in this case, as four photons are taking part in this process, four wave mixing process. One very prominent example, I'm not going into detail today, is CARS, yeah, coherent anti-Stokes Raman scattering microscopy. That's a four wave mixing process in tissue to detect, for example, certain chemical substances or lipid bodies and so on. So you need certain, again, you're using the symmetry of the material to detect an optical signal and thereby basically say, okay, I have this and this compound present. And you see in CARS, there's Raman involved, so somehow you can detect the vibrational levels of these molecules as well. Yeah, but very briefly, one major advantage of this nonlinearity is, for example, I plotted here again more detailed the scattering coefficient, yeah, of breast tissue and skin. And you see it's reduced at longer wavelengths. So if you imagine you have a certain fluorescent process a little bit above 500 nanometer, if you're using 1,000 something nanometers, you have a significantly reduced scattering coefficient, which enhances your penetration depth significantly. And here are just some images I took in lung tissue. For example, here you see some vascular structures in this image. This is part of the parenchyme, basically the skin around your lung, which is very flexible. And this is the transition between parenchyme and the alveolar bodies, basically the little bubbles in your lung, which increase in size if you inhale. Yeah? So these are air-filled and then surrounded by capillaries to take up the oxygen of the air. Yeah? And these are all taken without any dyes. So we didn't need any like fusion proteins or something else. So this is just purely on the nonlinear contrast, meaning, okay, what we are detecting is the symmetry of this structure in the tissue. For example, here, this green one, this is the collagen. Yeah, it looks a little bit like wool, yeah, woven into the tissue. Yeah? And these here are elastic fibers from elastine. Yeah? And they are basically responsible for this high elasticity of this tissue. Yeah? And this is the autofluorescence. So we're exciting fluorescence here in these elastin fibers with our femtosecond beam. And here, this is this second harmonic generation at the collagen molecules. And there, for example, one application is that we have biopsies from patients and we try to quantify from the structure of the collagen and the autofluorescence to diagnose certain kinds of lung diseases. For example, this is sarcoidosis, where you should have an enhanced signal of the collagen plotted here in red, for example. Yeah. Another example, I used or I work a lot, not really in regenerative medicine, but at other parts at the laser center in eye surgery using lasers, yeah, for example, to correct vision. Yeah, you see here an image of a living eye. Okay, that was not human in this case. This is a mouse eye from mice. You see here in green, you see a back endothelial layer of the cornea, so the very anterior part of the eye. So you see our anterior part of the eye is curved like this, yeah, and transparent. And this part in a human body is usually 1 millimeter thick, yeah, from here to here. And on top of that, we have an endothelial layer consisting of, several layers, maybe 5-6 layers of cells. And you see the mouse has a little bit more, so you see roughly the single nuclei in these cells here. So these are, maybe here you see the single cell layer, yeah, stacked on top of each other. And then you see here a major blue part, and this is just collagen. Yeah. So our main part of our human eye, of this anterior part, is just collagen to protect our eye from any impact and to build basically this curved structure. So it's a network of collagen packed like this and this on top of each other. Yeah? And then you see here, and this is actually where we used the green fluorescent protein. Yeah, actually, it was a yellow fluorescent protein, the genetically modified mice, to stain the neurons in these eyes. So even in our eyes, we have neuronal cells. You all know if you get a dust particle in the eye or if you have contact lenses, at some point it's itchy. Yeah, and this is because in this first layer, you have the nerve ends of these neurons, which you can see. And this we done all with nonlinear imaging. I mean, the purpose of this project was to be able to quantify the density of this nerve fiber layers in the human eye with microscopy as a way to see neurodegenerative diseases very early on in eyes. Yeah? Because if you think of a neurodegenerative disease, I mean, you have to get maybe a brain scan. Yeah, but it's not that we can all get brain scans and the doctor can tell you, oh, you have neurodegeneration. Usually nowadays, it's the other way around. People are basically in strange behavior and they, I don't know, let's say Alzheimer's disease, they tend to forget things and then people have certain tests and behavioral tests and then at some point they say, you are very likely to have Alzheimer's. Yeah, or but the final diagnosis can be made only post-mortem, which means, okay, you take the brain, you slice it into pieces, and then you can surely say this patient is diseased because of Alzheimer's. Yeah? And we hope to find optical ways to be early on able to detect that more precisely. Yeah? In this case, this was a diabetic study where we looked at the impact of diabetes on these nerve fiber layer, and actually you could see early on, the diabetes already, the neurodegenerative effect of diabetes in the eye before you have a clinical diagnosis already. Yeah, so that's one aspect, but not really regenerative medicine. Yeah. Okay, another aspect we have now in my lab, I'm really happy, is that we try to transfer that in other clinical applications, and therefore it's of course important that we have not this expensive microscope I told you, and you all know how your laser labs look like with a femtosecond laser and maybe the microscope, but you cannot put that into an operating theater with a cardiovascular surgeon or so. So we got now this device from Jenlab, a company started by one of the pioneers of multiphoton microscopy, Carsten König. And you see this is a picture I took just from my forearm. Okay, so you see here basically an epidermal layer, so basically the first deeper layer of my skin, and you could see that there's autofluorescence, there's some collagen in it, and you basically can do a non- or label-free imaging basically of the first layers as well. And that's, it's a flexible endoscope arm, so basically we have on top of that here, we have our objective lens, which we can put anywhere, we can roll it to the clinics and test it there for some applications. Yeah, and we're developing even more, like now a thin fiber system, yeah, so basically coupled to this objective lens here, a grin lens to get similar resolution here as a tip of 0.8 millimeters, so that you can even have some imaging, not only superficial skin imaging, but rather have, like for example, in living mice or rats, like a deep tissue imaging in a cardiovascular system. Okay, as a sort of outlook, which I'm not doing in my group on the very high resolution. So how can you, for example, go beyond the diffraction limit formulated by Ernst Abbe over a century ago? I wanted to briefly give you an insight into super resolution microscopy. And basically, there are two concepts out how you can improve the resolution of a standard microscope. So one we call localization microscopy, and the other one is STET, which stands for stimulated emission depletion microscopy. Yeah? So for the physicist among you, you see already, okay, there's stimulated emission in there. So it's somehow dealing with the fluorescent level in a microscope. Yeah? The localization is you cannot guess right away, but basically you can say both concepts are based on switching fluorescent molecules. Yeah? So you have to be able to switch the molecules from a fluorescent state to a non-fluorescent state. That's the principle of super resolution, which means if we go back, for example, to, even these images, I cannot I need to bring in an artificial dye which I can switch to get my super resolution. Yeah? In normal bright field microscopy, without labels, I cannot achieve super resolution. And that's why you cannot really say, they broke the diffraction barrier. Breaking the diffraction barrier sounds like, okay, the law is not valid anymore. But the law, diffraction law formulated by Abel is still valid, but they found a workaround to get a better resolution. But if you get a better resolution, you have to pay something to nature, yeah, and therefore you have to basically put in the dice, yeah, and you know the system, that it's a certain state system in the system, and therefore you gain an insight on information on the other side. So it, I wouldn't say that you really, they found a fundamental new law where Abel's law is not valid anymore. It's still valid, but they are using fluorescent systems to work around. And because there's a lot of fluorescent switching involved, again, the Nobel Prize was awarded for chemistry and not for physics. Yeah, usually if you would say they broke the diffraction law in microscopy, I would have expected, okay, that's a physics Nobel Prize, but it was awarded a chemistry Nobel Prize. And okay, Stefan Hell, I mean, he got made fun of in his lab by his colleagues. So when he came home from the Nobel ceremony, yeah, they gave him, like, you know, I don't know if you have that in Japan, probably like a chemistry experiment box you give to little skilled children in elementary school or something, yeah, where they can do some chemical experiments. Because in the German school system, you have to specialize in certain natural science courses, and he specialized in physics and got rid of chemistry. So in at the higher high school level, he didn't have any chemistry anymore. And then, so you could say he's not really a chemist, but he got a Nobel Prize in chemistry. So they gave him something like an educational chemistry kit to say, okay, you should learn chemistry now because you're a Nobel laureate in chemistry. Yeah. But anyway, long story short, it's because you're switching molecules involved, and therefore the technology is a little bit on the optics side, but you could say the great idea is on the chemical side. Yeah. Okay, what is the trick? Basically, the trick is that I showed you before this array disk of a single molecule. Yeah, and if you say you have a single molecule, and you know you have a single molecule present, you know how the array distribution is, and you know the position of the molecule much better than half the wavelengths. Because what Abel assumed is basically, okay, you have two, and to be able to tell them apart, one has to sit in the minimum of the other one, and you have this array disk on. It's something like you can relate to, if you will, Mount Fuji, where you say, okay, you would measure where the tip of Mount Fuji is by saying, okay, well, I only know the distribution is this large, and I'm taking the full width half maximum. So somewhere in between here has to be the tip of Mount Fuji. But you know much better if you look at it, you know, okay, the tip has to be somewhere here in the middle. Yeah? And similarly, it's with a fluorescent molecule. If you have one molecule and the distribution looks like this, yeah, you wouldn't say, oh, it has to sit somewhere between here and here, maybe here or here. Yeah, you know it has to be in the middle somewhere. Yeah? If you know it's only one molecule, it has to be at the center of this light distribution. And that's the trick you're using in localization. Yeah? You have your point spread function, which is limited by the diffraction limit and has this shape, yeah, like half the wavelength in this direction, worse in axial direction. And you have this distribution of it. And if you're sure that it's a light distribution from only one molecule, you can say, okay, it's probably in the very middle. Yeah? So instead of this distribution, you have this distribution. Yeah? But for that, you have to be sure that you have only one molecule present. And that's why it's your switching on and off. And this is what I meant with this one here. Yeah, the principle is you have a weak on pulse, so that on average in your imaging area, you have only a few molecules on, giving an array disk distribution, and they should not overlap, which means, okay, you're adjusting the light intensity such that, statistically speaking, you have maybe a few molecules which are more than half the wavelengths apart. Yeah? And then afterwards, you switch them all off, you switch them on and off and so on. So you see, to take one image, you easily switch on and off your molecules 1,000 times. Yeah? And if you do that with a normal standard dye molecule, they can easily break or go in a dark state and be lost for the fluorescence. And that's why so much chemistry was involved in developing suitable photoswitchable dyes where you can do that a lot of times. Yeah? And this is an example I just put pulled any paper from Eric Betzig, yeah, where you see that they can get really high resolution palm images like with resolutions well below this diffraction limit. You should know, okay, if you look localization techniques, there are, for example, palm microscopy, F-palm, storm, SIM5, and so on. So there are maybe like 10 different names for the same principle. This is because, I should say, as an outsider of the microscopy developers, that was out of the times before the Nobel Prize was awarded. Yeah, I was at these conferences, yeah, and you have to imagine everyone was working with localization microscopy, and they knew soon there will be an award. Yeah, so what do? You give your own technique, an own name, yeah, to say, okay, I did this, that's my idea. Yeah, and then they dated a lot, like, okay, I had the idea 1978, here's the paper, there. And so a lot of the talks on the super resolution microscope, the first 10 minutes, the speaker said, really, I did this, I had this idea, and this is, so my impression was to basically position themselves in the arena of the Nobel Prize. Yeah? And now, since the Nobel Prize can be only given to 3 persons, they are away. It's much more relaxed at the fluorescence microscopy conferences nowadays. So what stands out a little bit, what was clear to me, again, as an outsider view, was that, okay, this principle has a lot of fathers, scientifically speaking, mothers, yeah. It was really hard to guess who should get the Nobel Prize in the field of localization microscopy, yeah. But the other technique, stimulated emission microscopy, depletion microscopy, was invented by Stefan Hell, and that's really a different method. So to me, I thought, okay, when they give a Nobel Award for super resolution microscopy, probably he will be one, and the other one could be several people. Yeah? Okay, and his idea is basically that you're not switching the whole field of view with a weak beam, it's rather you have one focused beam which has this light distribution which is limited by Abbe's diffraction limit, and you have a second pulse which is shaped the other way around, so which leaves out the central part, yeah, and has the other one, and with this one you're switching the molecules off. Yeah? You have to think of this one excites the molecule, and normally in fluorescence the molecules sit there maybe a nanosecond, and then they fall down to the ground level and emit the fluorescence light. If you, within this one nanosecond, yeah, another photon comes with the same wavelengths matching the energy gap in the atom, you know you can have stimulated emission. What will the molecule do? Okay, the electron will relaxate and send out a second photon in the same direction. That's the principle of the laser. Yeah? If you think about it now on fluorescence microscopy, it's okay, you're sending in the redshifted fluorescent light with a laser, and thereby all these atoms here in this area here are sending out light in this direction. Yeah? And then afterwards you wait and let the remaining molecules fluoresce, and only this fluorescence you're detecting, not the stimulated emission coherent light, you don't care for that. Yeah? So thereby you're switching off these molecules within this nanosecond, and the remaining fluorescent spot is not limited by diffraction limit anymore. Yeah? It's more limit on the intensity of this incoming beam in comparison to this second beam. Yeah? You can imagine if I turn the energy up, the intensity up, then the outskirts here get even more into this area and switch off more molecules, and this spot gets effectively even smaller. So the limit of STET, it basically doesn't have a theoretical limit. It's more like a limit of how high can you have the depletion pulse until you burn your sample. Yeah. And this is how it looks like. You see you're increasing the switching beam. You see first you cannot see a structure, then a finer structure, finer, and you can resolve really fine structures here. Yeah. And the resolution demonstrated in this case with the beads was below 25 nanometers with an 800 nanometer beam. Yeah, remember, we had this diffraction limit, 800 nanometer divided by 2 times the numerical aperture, so roughly 2. So the diffraction limit is basically overcome by a factor of something like, 20 or something like that. Okay, that's I mean, we start to implement some super resolution techniques, but the problems I see, or in other words, put what a lot of groups work on now in the super resolution business, is try to get that away from only synth samples and very limited penetration depths. Because, for example, in STET microscopy, the STET beam is a, we call it donut beam, or ring-shaped beam, is very sensitive to aberrations. So if you have a higher penetration depth, it's very hard to reach this clean beam shapes in higher depths, even of a single cell layer. And that's what people, for example, work on. But the last maybe 10 minutes, I wanted to speak about methods in having, okay, what about millimeter and centimeter samples, or maybe a whole mouse? Can we do optical imaging in these areas? And if we look now at the different scales, so you see here are single DNA molecules curled around, how they are packed in the nucleus. Here you see a single cell, tissue constructs, embryos, and whole mice. We have in Hanover, we work on very similar scales. You see, we have cell spheroids where we grow stem cells to, for example, grow heart muscle tissue from it. They have a size of 300 micron in diameter, and therefore we need to get the fully image of them, a 300 micrometer penetration depth, like these stem cell clusters, artificial heart muscle, or in the other excellence cluster, we work even with bone structure. There the penetration depth is even worse, because bone, it looks white, so it's strongly scattering structure bone, and to do optical imaging in these structures is very hard. So one thing we started with are these constructs of artificial heart muscle. So the idea of these constructs is, in, like I told you in the beginning, if you had a heart attack, your heart muscle doesn't really regrow or regenerate, that they take a sample from your skin cells, and nowadays you can reprogram them, with the so-called Yamanaka factors. Probably you heard of the Nobel Prize in that field as well, and reset them to a stem cell state, and then afterwards grow heart muscle tissue. And the important thing is that this heart muscle has the genetic code of the patient in it. It's not like you don't get any immune response. It's grown from your own body, by so-called genetic reprogramming. And you see these heart muscle constructs after 10 to 15 days, they tend to beat spontaneously, where you really see that it's contracting heart muscle tissue. And my colleague Ina Gru is cultivating then in such reactors here. So she pours the stem cells in and has some of these metal bars, and the metal bars are for pulling on them, like in a little mini cell gym. You have to put mechanic stress on these cells so that they form collagen and align and building these heart muscle patches. And this is a histological cut afterwards, and you see the collagen in red here, and in green the heart muscle cells, and in blue the single nuclei, so that you can count the density of the cells and you can estimate the compound and the content of collagen in it. And she was very unhappy with these images, because for one of these images she had to fix the cells, slice them, or the sample, slice them into pieces, because the penetration depth of the standard microscope is too limited to do that. So we thought of a technique to solve that, and basically we built something like an optical CT. So you see we have our sample in here, we have two imaging objectives, and instead of having a normal microscope, we are rotating now the sample. So it's very similar to what you maybe know from clinical imaging. You put a patient into a source and a detector, and okay, you're not rotating the patient, but you're rotating source and detector, and you can get a 3D image with X-rays. And the principle is basically from computer tomography, is that you have your X-rays, and you you're collecting the X-rays on a detector, and you're measuring the attenuation. If you have bones in the way of the X-rays, you get less intensities. If it's only soft tissue, you get a higher intensity. And you're collecting a so-called tomogram, which means you're rotating. Okay, in this case, I rotated the sample. And if I'm plotting now the intensities of each of these detectors, I'm getting a so-called sinogram, which means I'm getting the plotted intensities at different angles. And I can use a so-called Radon transformation to get back basically the distribution of absorbers within the specimen. So that's how computer tomography works. And we did the same for optics, yeah, which means, okay, for that I have to have rays of light going through my sample and be able to project the absorption, for example, along one pass, or the fluorescence along one pass, and collect such a cyanogram to get a 3D distribution. Yeah? So with these heart muscle tissue, this works. So you see we can estimate the collagen and the cell density, and in green the cells. So this worked quite well. And okay, you can do that on inch transparent samples as well, do that in reflection, yeah, as well, and thereby quantify, for example, biofilm formation and so on dental implants. But what I want to motivate with this more, yeah, if you get larger structures, you get a problem, even if you're using infrared wavelengths with scatterings. Yeah, so the light doesn't go like X-rays through the tissue, it's really going wiggling way and is distorted, and you cannot get projection data. Yeah? So if you think about it, why is tissue not transparent for visible or infrared light? Yeah, I brought you an example, of course, from Germany, yeah, where you see, okay, let's think of tissue as, for example, beer. Yeah, and if you look at your glass of beer, it's completely filled with beer, but on the top, usually it looks white, and on the bottom, it's more or less transparent or yellow. Yeah? If you think of it, you have an opaque part, a transparent part, but basically it's all beer in there. Yeah. So before the glass is transparent, you have one bottle of beer which is sort of transparent, maybe yellow, and you pour it in, and suddenly you have an opaque region and you have a transparent region. Yeah? Okay, of course you know, okay, in these little bubbles you have, let's say, air, yeah, or carbon dioxide in there, so you have a gas in there, but that's transparent too. Yeah? So if you look at it, you have a bubbly structure here, which is suddenly strongly scattering. And this is, of course, because of the mismatch of index of refraction. Yeah? So in air, you have a very low index of refraction, or carbon dioxide, and in beer, you have a higher refractive index similar to water, maybe 1.35. Yeah? So, and if now a light ray comes in into this foam, yeah, it gets distorted and you get this Y scattering. It's the same what happens in clouds, just the other way around. You have air and you have little droplets of water, and if you look at a cloud, it basically looks white, yeah? The same like the beer foam. Yeah, what can you do if you imagine I fill up now all these bubbles with beer, yeah, then it's suddenly transparent. And this is what you see here. Yeah? Yeah? So it's all beer, I get it. And this is exactly what you can do with tissue and what people call so-called optical clearing, yeah? Which means, I give you one example what we patented, but there are, we called it crystal, the clearing media, but you see, for example, there are several companies which licensed this, or several research groups came up with this, and each research group, again, like before, yeah, has its own brand. And for example, you can get one optical clearing agent from Olympus, you can get one from Nikon, and you can get one from Zeiss, and they all have different names. And ours is Crystal, and we licensed it to a small company name, you probably don't know, La Vision Biotech, a microscopy company close by. But here's what you see what happens. You know, I put there a lung tissue on the upper image, yeah, and lung tissue is similarly like beer foam because of these little bubbles in there of air. Yeah? So you have a lot of air bubbles inside this tissue and it looks white. And if I manage to fill that up with index matching fluid, yeah, I have only like remaining absorption, so that only the absorption is dominating in the tissue, but the rest goes through like X-rays. And now I can use this sample to do optical projection tomography. You see the protocol is a bit complicated to do so, but I'm gonna leave that out. But with this, for example, I mean, we took images of zebrafish, for example, and these are not transparent, but adult zebrafish, but maybe you see it better in this graph. This is a lung slide now taken as volume data in 3D with optics, and you see here the scale, yeah, several centimeters in scale, imaged with optical projection tomography. Yeah? And the special thing about our resin we use for the optical clearing is that afterwards you can embed these samples for standard microscopy techniques. For example, we sliced off half of the sample and then did nonlinear microscopy. Yeah? So you see, you can now look in this whole lung. We have the whole data set of these contrast modalities I've shown you before, of these nonlinear, like collagen content, autofluorescence of the nuclei. And you see this is really like sort of Google Maps. You have an overview of the whole organ, yeah? And you can zoom in at a cellular level with very high resolution. And then on top of that, if you now, because you have the whole 3D data set, yeah, you can now even take a restaining and staining for other structures like rhodamine, phalloidine, or DARPI, and afterwards use this one for standard histology. That's more like a medical aspect where you really have standard pathology looking at that one, and you know now from which site in your organ this histology was taken, because you have the whole 3D data set in your computer. And then afterwards, you can even use this histology to prepare it for electron microscopy. So you can now even take images with electron microscopy with, like, let's say, 10 nanometer resolution and say, okay, I took that within my whole lung on a centimeter scale from this position, yeah? Which means, okay, in terms of Google Maps, yeah, you have the whole city of Tokyo, maybe, and you can zoom in to one street, one address to really know. And we do that by switching the different imaging microscopy techniques. Of course, this is not optical imaging anymore, it's electron microscopy. You have to embed it quite differently, okay? Yeah, so with this, I'm nearly at the end of my talk, just as an outlook, or just for you, as this is a tutorial as well. There are other techniques which work in 3D as well, and I don't want to leave that out. For example, Stelzeit Al, he worked a lot, a long time in Heidelberg, is now in Frankfurt at the university. He developed a lot like the SPIM microscopy, selective plane imaging microscopy, or similarly, you could say Dott et al. Came up with the ultra microscopy. Yeah, similar, you have a light sheet and try to collect the data in different layers and get a very quick 3D acquisition. And what are we doing in this environment at the moment? Yeah, we basically put all together, I've shown you before, like we have our femtosecond laser and we use our optical CT and we do that all together in this optical CT scanner with nonlinear optics as well. And just that you see that it's still a physics playground, if you want, is that if you now have this collagen molecule and you do your rotation in your CT, you get a problem because you will see that if you have a nonlinear optics lecture as well, that your signal is now modulated with a rotation angle and you cannot apply the normal Radon transformation and to reconstruct the image. So basically you have to combine nonlinear optics with the standard deconvolution algorithm and then basically put that in, and then we are able to, you see here, then reconstruct really the whole 3D thing with nonlinear optics. And that's maybe one, yeah, if you want to do some more reading, that's a recent paper from Lena Nolte, who worked on this nonlinear imaging process. Okay, that's more like an outlook as well. And with that, I thank you very much for listening on this first talk. I hope I didn't scare you off for tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Alex. And any question from the audience? Oh. No, his talk was started from the fundamental to the cutting edge technology. So, and also, yeah, he kindly managed his presentation for the bachelor's and the graduate students. So, it's a great chance for you to ask questions you may have.
Oh. For the last part of your talk, you mentioned on the liquid, index patching liquid. Is this non-toxic?
No, it's toxic, yeah. I mean, there are some groups, for example, Valerie Turin is working on this technique, especially in vivo since probably 20 years, optical cleaving. And they work with some glucose and oil solutions to still get in living specimen an optical clearing, but that's very limited. It's not that you can clear a whole mouse and still get an image. But they, for example, try, one application was in the eye. You see you have a white part of the eye which is strongly scattering, and people try to image through that using sugar solutions, and they improved the penetration depths by 3 times, but I mean, still, so you can use that to to some degree, but it's very limited. Yeah. On the other hand, if you have fixed specimen and dead specimen, you can optically clear even whole human. Yeah, it would take for the chemicals to diffuse in would probably take some years. Yeah, but I mean, if you look on the web, there are people who optically cleared a whole turtle, yeah, like this size, yeah, with the shield and everything. But you could clear that. It takes again probably a year as well. But so for let's say, for example, a mouse heart, which we cleared optically as well, that was maybe 2 weeks optical clearing. It's just because the principle is, that you get rid of the water, which has a very low refractive index compared to the proteins and other structures, and you replace it by other kind of chemicals. And these chemicals are usually very toxic. And first you get the water out by replacing it with alcohol, and then you're mixing the alcohol with your chemicals, and thereby you're increasing refractive index up to the respective tissue. And these chemicals are usually very toxic.
Thank you for your presentation. I have one question from two-photon microscopy. You can induce two-photon absorption in a deep position, but the detected green light has shorter optical penetration depth, so is the depth you can observe is limited?
Yes.
Limited by the optical penetration depth of green light?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, it's dependent on both. So on one hand, the focus gets worse the deeper you're getting. But you're correct, that you're generating visible light, which experiences much more absorption and scattering in deeper layers. So at one point, the fluorescent light doesn't reach the surface anymore, and you cannot detect it. But on the other hand, usually you can apply very sensitive detectors to work at a very high quantum efficiency. So basically every photon which gets out in this direction, you can nearly detect, or let's say every second photon you can detect. So, and that's one advantage of multiphoton microscopy is you don't need to know, or you don't need to image this photon, you have just to detect it, which means, okay, you're generating one, but it doesn't have to go back like in imaging paths, it can basically scatter, and as long as it gets back out of the surface of the tissue, you're detecting it, and you know where it was because you have your excitation laser at a certain point. So you get your spatial resolution not from the spatial imaging of the fluorescent photons like you would do in standard fluorescence microscopy. You get your spatial information from your laser beam. Yeah. So therefore, I mean, and there, at the visible range, dominating is still the scattering, and that's not really too important as long as the photon gets out. But it's still in the end, finally, you're limited by the limited penetration depths of the visible light combined with the aberration effects on your focus. Yeah? So, which means in the end, you go to a certain depth, yeah, and you have to generate enough photons to be able to detect, and then you have to turn up the power, and at some point the power at the surface of your specimen is too high and you burn your sample. Yeah, that's the limit for two-photon microscopy in living animals, yeah, if you want to be exact. Yeah, you don't want to put in or create photo damage by your excitation beam. Yeah.
Thank you.
And I mean, to somewhat match that, if you Google, for example, now, people come up with methods, if you nonlinear microscopy and look what are recent publications on the technical side on this, they are moving towards maybe 3 or 4 photon imaging, yeah, and thereby try to shift all these wavelengths further into the infrared, yeah, to reduce these effects even more. And people like Chris Schaefer in Cornell, he demonstrated that at the spine of living mouse that he was able to get a 3 photon process imaging and achieve higher penetration depths compared to 2 photon. Again, same effects. Yeah.
Thanks for your lecture. So I'm interested in the super resolution techniques. So basically, in order to achieve diffraction, to break down the diffraction limitation, you have to, for example, to take more images in the localization technique, or you have to increase your power to increase the resolution, like in the stat.
Yeah.
So and maybe there's other technique like structured emission microscopy, and maybe this same thing, like you have to take more images. So in your point of view, so for this super resolution technique, what would be the most optimized technique in terms of the efficiency to achieve this super resolution? I mean, in the time to use less time or using less power?
It's hard to tell. It's because both techniques, localization and STET, have advanced since the Nobel Prizes quite dramatically. So even there's, for example, a CW STET with moderate powers, which get quite high high resolution, depending on the development of the suitable dyes as well. So, but from speed and versatility, my point of view is at the moment I would prefer the localization microscopy, because they recently they had some science publications where they had really 3D images of a whole nucleus in a cell with very high resolution and video rate. So although you take a lot of images, it's so optimized the process and the dyes that you can, let's say you take 1,000 images and still are able to get a whole resolution. But that's a very personal view. Yeah, probably if Stefan Hell would be here, he would argue heavily against it with other. I mean, it's as well probably in the microscopy business, then they are split in two parts. One saying, okay, we have a localization microscope, we follow that, and the other ones use a STET microscope. But I mean, the other one thing, one has to take basically a lot of images to increase the resolution. And the other one, if you increase the resolution, you have a much smaller spot. So you're increasing the number of pixels, or you have to reduce the point of view. Because of the Nyquist criteria, you have to sample more densely then. So in both ways, I mean, they have their backdraws. And I mean, in localization, again, personal view, you don't have the issues too much with what I meant with the aberration of your depletion beam. I think that's really one major issue if you want to have deeper layers of imaging. But although, again, Stefan would probably say, okay, we did multi-layer STET imaging and so on, but it's very sensitive, what I know, for the STET beam due to aberrations, and it's hard to correct. And in localization, you don't have these issues. You just need to get moderate intensity there, and then you do all your processing afterwards.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm a neurophysiologist. So, I'm interested in the whole brain imaging or large scale neuron activity imaging and the small nervous system. And so the, especially the voltage imaging instead of calcium imaging. So to reconstruct the first signal, like action potential, we need the several kilohertz frame rate. So the of course it depends on the availability of the camera, CCD camera, and also the important factor is the Z-stack movement.
Yeah.
So as far as I know, the light seed technique is suitable for that.
Yeah.
But is there any other solution to achieve it?
So, what maybe for the other ones, what you're referring to is that you need a very high imaging speed because the action potentials are on a very small scale, milliseconds, or I don't know. You need a very high temporal resolution and spatial resolution ideally, if you have the different neurons and you want to see one fires and then the other one and so on. So you have a 3D volume where you want to have a high spatial resolution and temporal resolution. And if you imagine you have a femtosecond beam and you have a resolution, let's say, of a micron or maybe half a micron and you scan it, you have 80 million pulses, but you have to drill in every position to get enough photons out. To get enough photons back, you have to rest your point at your focus at for 1 or 3 microseconds, and then you move on. So if you have, let's say, 1 microsecond, you know you can collect 1 million pixels at a time, so which limits your resolution of your image already. And if you then want to, and that would be in 1 second. Yeah. So and if you increase factor of 1,000, you know, okay, you can look at 1,000 pixels in 1 millisecond. Yeah? Of course, you can increase the efficiency and get better dyes and so on to increase it. But what I've seen recently from Peter So, one of the inventors of multiphoton microscopy, that was very smart, is that he used an optical setup, a spatial light modulator, to have your different foci at different positions. So basically, he took a full scan of your brain to know where are the neurons, and then he looked only, I mean, that one neuron fires, you don't need to image the whole neuron. Yeah, you just have to image one position, and you have to know, okay, what is the calcium signal, for example, at this position. Yeah. And therefore, he chose, I don't know, 100 positions in this living brain, and was able to scan the beam then very fast, so that he had sub-millisecond resolution on these different neurons in a whole neuronal network, yeah, for some time, because it remodels over time. But that was really impressive, and that that was, to my knowledge, the fastest action potential imaging in 3D so far. And I think it's a good idea. It's first you get a Google map to know where are the streets, and then you want to monitor at certain crossroads, you want to monitor the traffic, yeah. But you don't need to collect the traffic in whole Tokyo, yeah, if you're interested in 100 crossroads in Tokyo. So you should only measure at these positions. And they basically generated a laser beam at these positions. So to not really image the structure anymore, but just get a dynamic imaging of the signal. Yes, it should be published. Yeah, if you look, Peter So from, he's at MIT still, or I think from MIT, you should be able. Otherwise, send me a mail. I can try to look it up, the paper. Yeah.
Okay, you may have more questions, but our time is up. So let's thank the Professor Alex Sandheister-Kamp again. Thank you very much. And today we close the lecture today. And just announcement, tomorrow we also have another lecture from Professor Heisterkamp about the more on the laser-based manipulation, including the cell surgery, transfection, and also optogenetics. So you are welcome to come back again to the lecture tomorrow. Thanks again for coming today.